All right, I'm very excited to be here. We're going to have a great time together. I want to say hi to all of my friends and family on Facebook. We are live in Glendale, Arizona. So if you have any question, any comment, you can always ask us and email us, you know, or, you know, just send us a text. Remember, we study law versus grace for the last couple of weeks. So today we're going to keep going with it again, law versus grace. So you need to know you are under the law, not under, you are under the grace, not under the law. Let me repeat it again if you hear it wrong. We are under the grace, not under the law. So last week, I talked about the law showed favor to the good. So if you are good, so the law give you favor. So the favor based on how good you are. But the grace shows mercy and favor to the ungodly. So those who are sinners, God wants, you know, God willing, God give, show favor to those people. And also we said law, what the law was outwardly graven upon stones. So the law, God gave the law to Moses and the two tablet stones. But remember, the law is not only the Ten Commandments. It's 613 commandments. So you need to keep that in mind. When we talk about law, sometimes people think about Ten Commandments. It's more than that. Okay? And you have to obey all of them. If you disobey one, you disobey all of them. So, and last week we talked about that. We said grace is graven inwardly, Christ in you. I mean, through Christ in you. So it is in your heart now. Also said the law says he added no more. That's it. And the grace, you know, assure us we can still, God still speaking through his son, Jesus. Number 9, last week we said law is inexorable and it demands. So the law was tough, you know, in his demand. But we said the grace of God is inspirational and it's blessing. So when you know how much blessing you have, you know, God already pour on you, that inspires you very, very much. Number 10, last week we said the law brings judgment, but it's a grace brings justification. The law brings judgment, grace justifies you. So that means grace make you free. Number 11, we say law cry out, keep the commandment, all of them, in a minute detail. But the grace said, hey, we are kept by the power of God. Instead of keep the commandments, but God is the one who keep us. So by his power. Well, tonight, I'm going to get into number 12, the difference between grace and law, or the difference between law and grace. Well, tonight, the first thing I'm going to tell you, the law demands love. The law demands love. I want you to look at Deuteronomy 6, verse 4 and 5. Verse 4 and 5. Somebody with this for me, real quick.
Listen, Israel, the Lord our God is the only true God. So love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and strength.
All right. So the law, you know, require for you to Listen to love the Lord with all of your strength, all of your might, you know, love the Lord. But I want you to look at the grace. The grace of God exhibit love. Instead of us, you know, running to trying to love God, but under the grace, God is the one who shows love towards us. Look at John chapter 3, verse 16. It is the most common verse in the Bible, John 3, 16. Somebody with this, please.
For this is how much God loved the world. He gave his one and only unique Son as a gift. So now everyone who believes in him will never perish, but experience everlasting life.
All right, so pay attention to this verse. It is very important. He said, for this is how much God loved the world. Because some people get confused. They think God loved the church people or the Christian or whatever religion they are. But this verse said God so loved the world, the entire world. Okay, so what do you mean? Even those who's doing things they shouldn't do, God loves them. That's what I mean. That's what this verse means. Okay, so God loves them. It is not just to love them. But you're going to see that. He said he gave his one and only unique Son as a gift. So you need to understand that verb. He gave. So it's already done it. What he gave? He gave his only and uniquely Son, Jesus, as a gift. What does that mean? You don't pay for a gift. Do you understand that? You don't give nothing in return for a gift. Listen, if you give me a gift and then you say, Joseph, you know what? You know, I want something back. So, it's not a gift.
Yeah.
Ah. Now somebody start to understand John 3:16. So, it is not a trade. If you pray me, if you fasting, if you give money, so guess what? I'm going to love you. This thing is not a gift. It's just a trade. Religious people, they try to make a trade with God. God, you give me life, but so I'm going to give you this. No. Okay, whatever God gives you, they just give. And nothing in return. That's why God don't kill those who doesn't love him. He could kill all of them. He don't do that. Because he's the loving God. Don't you ever hear people cursing at God? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So don't you think God can just say, all right, let me borrow my life of breath. You know? So, but hey, God still loved them. In spite of, you know, what they say about him. In spite of how they behave themselves. God still loves them. But there is a trick with that. God loves you. Yes, that's very true. But at the same time, there is a little condition in this verse. He said, so now, everyone who believes in him will never perish. He says, everyone who believes. So let's look at the opposite of that. What about if someone refuses to believe? Are you with me? If someone is refused to believe, guess what? They're going to perish. It's not because God is not a loving God. Some people get that twisted. They think because God is a loving God, so nobody going to perish. There is a little condition here. You have to believe in the sacrifice, you know, Jesus did for you. That's the only thing. Just believe that. If you don't believe that, guess what? You going to perish. Well, he said, but experience everlasting life. So if you believe in Jesus, you're going to experience everlasting life. That life will never end. Okay? So that's the difference between law and grace. The law said, hey, you know, you got to love God, you know, more than everything. But the grace said, God loves you more than everything. Don't you love that?
Yes, amen.
Thank you, Jesus. All right, now, number 13. The law moves the sinners to sin. The law moves the sinners to sin. I want you to look at this verse in Romans chapter 7, verse 7 and 8. Romans 7, verse 7 and 8. Somebody with this one, please.
What shall we say then? Is the law sinful? Certainly not. Nevertheless, I would not have known what sin was had it not been for the law. For I would not have known what coveting really was if the law had not said, you shall not covet. But sin, seizing the opportunity offered by the commandment, produced in me every kind of coveting, far apart from the law, and sin was dead.
Yes. So, listen to this. Paul says, so what shall we say about this, all of this? So he said, am I suggesting that the law is sinful? No, the law is not sinful. He said, of course not. He said, in fact, it was the law that gave us the clear definition of sin. In other words, if there was no law, guess what? No sin. Just like there is three light, yellow, red, and green. Because there are three light, that creates a law. They say you can drive only under the green light. He said the yellow light announces for you to stop. And he said, the red light, you must stop. So guess what happened? Because of that law, when you take the red light, you sin. So let's put that in a jungle where there is no light, there is no law how to drive. You can drive without thinking about sin, about taking a traffic ticket. Because there is no law. That's exactly what Paul tried, you know, to explain to us. Because the law said, do not covet it. So if there is no law, nobody even care about covering. Okay, he said it became the catalyst to see how wrong it was for me to crave what belonged someone else, what belonged to someone else. So the law, because of the law, so that's why we become sinners. So that's why we said the law moved sinner to sin. Because the law show you are a sinner. Okay? So he said it was through God's commandment that sin was awakened in me and built it based of operation within me to stir up every kind of warm desire. So let's say again, no law, no sin. Do you understand that? Okay, so the law is the one who awaken sin, who show, who point out sin. Okay, so now he said, for in this absence of the law, sin hid dormant. So sin just sleeping. Without law, sin sleeping. But the law wake sin up. Okay? So now, look at the grace. The grace of God removes sin from the sinner. The law point out the sin to the sinner, but the grace removes sin from the sinner. I want somebody to look at Matthew chapter 1, verse 20 to 21. Louder, a little bit louder.
Oh, I'm sorry. Don't hesitate to take Mary into your home as your wife, because the power of the Holy Spirit has conceived a child in her womb. She will give birth to a son, and you are to name him Savior, he is destined to give his life to save his people from their sins.
All right. Hear that. That's a beautiful story. Joseph and Mary, they were fiancé. And then suddenly, Mary became pregnant. And Joseph knew he did not have an affair with Mary, so how in the world for Mary to get pregnant? Okay? So now, watch this. He said, while Joseph was still debating with himself about what to do, he fell asleep and had a supernatural dream. So Joseph was debating to himself. He did not post it on Facebook. He did not post it on Instagram or Twitter. He did not do that. What he did, he just debating on himself. Say, God, self, what am I going to do with a pregnant woman? I don't even know who the father is, And then, while he was debating, he fell asleep and then get into a supernatural dream. He said, an angel from the Lord appeared to him in that dream in clear light and said, you need to pay attention. So who appeared to Joseph? Talk to me. The angel appeared to Joseph, okay? He said, so if an angel appeared to you, or let's say if the angel appeared to Joseph, so who sent that angel?
God.
All right, you need to know who sent that angel. So God sent that angel. He said, Joseph, that's what the angel said to him. He said, Joseph, descendant of David, don't hesitate to take Mary into your home as your wife, because the power of the Holy Spirit has conceived a child in her womb. So the angel said to Joseph, hey, the child, embrace the child and the mother, because that child from God. Okay? So, listen to that one. He said, she will give birth to a son. Who said, who keep talking to Joseph? You need to know that. Who keep talking to Joseph?
The angel.
Okay? So, you need to pay attention to this one. Because that wasn't, you know, Matthew just writing that. That was a word from the angel. Matthew just recorded. So now, listen to that. He said, she will give birth to a son, and you are to name the son, to name him Savior. You need to understand that. In the Jewish culture, when you name something, the name you give the thing, that's what it is. Let me help you with that. If you call this one picture, it is picture. Do you understand? If you call this one dog, that's dog. That's an animal. Okay? So, the angel said to Joseph, you're going to call the baby Savior. What does that really mean? So that means he is the Savior. Okay? So now he said, for he is destined to give his life to save his people from what? Okay, we need to pay attention to that. The angel said the baby is a savior. Savior for what? Savior of what? Savior, okay, you say savior of the world, that's fine. To save who?
The people.
To save the people from what?
Sin.
Did you know Jesus came? The baby already came. Did you know about that?
Yeah.
Don't look at me like you shocked. Because some of y'all don't know if the baby born already. Because let me tell you, if you really believe the baby was born, and the baby was the savior of people to save them from sin. So what sin you talking about?
My sin.
Sin of man.
Okay, so the baby already born as the savior. The baby already give his life as the savior. He give his life to do what? To save his people from their sins. So now you in church, you talk about sin. What sin you talking about?
The people.
Some people still don't get it yet. Some people still don't get it. Yeah. We need to understand Jesus came to take away our sin. So when you believe in Jesus, he took away your sin.
Yes. That,
exactly. So nothing to talk about. Because he took them away.
Yes.
But people will say, well, Joseph, what about what I did this morning? I did something wrong. Stop doing it. Give me a break. Stop doing it. Stop sinning. That's why you keep thinking about sinning, because you keep doing it. But you don't know if you have power to stop doing it. That's what you don't know. But the way you're going to experience that power, that's when you believe he took away your sin. You are not, hear the trick. There's a trick who come with it. Hear the trick. If you try to move yourself from sin, you will not be able to do that on your own. I tried for 27 years, it wasn't working. So don't even waste your time. Okay, so you cannot take your sin away of you. That's what some people said, you know what, you know, I need to leave that bad habit before I come to Jesus. Guess what happened? You just deceived. Because you cannot do it on your own. Some people, even though they come, but they still believe they are sinners. So, as a man believes in his heart, so is he. Okay? As a man thinks in his heart, so is he. So, the man needs to think he is God's righteousness. As you think like that, guess what happened? So, you give access to the power of righteousness to release into your life. The trick is, you need to believe it in order for you to see its action. I know you don't hear what I said. Because if you hear that, you will jump. So, listen. The trick is this. You need to believe it first. As you believe, Jesus took away your sin. Guess what happened? So, that gives you power over sin. But let's look at the opposite. You don't believe Jesus took away your sin. Guess what happened? Your sin stay with you. This is the secret.
Yes. Amen.
So now, look at that. All right. Jesus came. The baby already came. I love that. All right. Number 14, according to the law, nearness to God is impossible. So come close to God is impossible according to the law. Look at Exodus 20, verse 21. Somebody have it? You can read it for me.
So don't forget that you were not born as Jews and were uncircumcised.
Oh, how come I don't have it in this? I'll open your Bible real quick. It's not this one. Do you have it? I don't know. I don't see it here. Exodus 20, verse 21. Somebody read it.
You read it already. Huh? According to the law, nearness to God is impossible.
Oh, no. All right, open the Bible. Yeah. Somebody find it? Go ahead. Exodus 20, verse 21.
The people remained at a distance while Moses approached the thick darkness where God was.
All right. So the people stay
at a distance.
Huh?
At a distance.
At a distance when Moses went to the thick, to the presence of God, anyway. So the people, they couldn't come close to God. So the law, it was impossible to come close to God. Oh, look at the grace. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 11 and 13. I do have that on the paper. Go ahead. Somebody with this.
So don't forget that you were not born as Jews and you were uncircumcised. Circumcision itself is just a work of man's hands. You had none of the Jewish covenants and laws. You were foreigners to Israel's incredible heritage. You were without the covenants and the prophetic promise hope and without God. Yet look at you now. Everything is new. Although you were once distant and far away from God, now you have been brought delightfully close to Him through the sacred blood of Jesus. You have actually been united to Christ.
Amen. Well, the only thing, I really love that reading, but it's just too fast. All right. Yes. So, thank you. Yes, it was good. He said, so, don't forget that. You were not born as Jews. You know, sometimes people think they, I don't know what happened, what's going wrong. You know, people that try, you know, one time somebody come to me, he said, do you know what tribe you came from? I said, what are you talking about? You know, I'm not a Jew. I'm not. I mean, you know, don't think you are Jews. You are not. You know, we are a different nation. Okay? So, he said, not born as Jews. Paul said that we were not born as Jews. Okay, and were uncircumcised. Okay, he said circumcision itself is just a work of man's hand. Okay, he said you had none of the Jewish covenant. My goodness, I wish my Seventh Day Adventist can hear that. You know, can read this scripture, they can understand. Okay, you have none of the Jewish covenant and laws. Did you see that in your Bible? Did you have this verse in your Bible? He said, you were foreigners to Israel's incredible heritage. We were foreigners when it came to the Jewish. Okay? He said, you were without the covenant and prophetic promises of the Messiah. So all the prophecy, you know, Isaiah, Jeremiah, you know, all the Old Testament, it wasn't for us. They were about the Jewish with the Messiah. Okay? So it says, the promise, hope, and without God. So we were without God. Okay? He said, oh, I love that. He said, yet, look at you now. Everything is new. Look at you now. Everything is new. I'm sure when Paul says that, he did not say, look at you now, everything is new. I just imagine Paul saying, look at you now. You know, it's kind of like, show them, you know, look at you now. He said, everything is new.
Amen.
That's why when somebody asks you, how you doing? You can say, I am fresh and
new.
You can say, I am fresh and new.
Amen.
Do not worry about if they shock. That's fine. You talk from the spirit. Let them shock. As a matter of fact, when you say that, you just release, you know, something on them and their life. You just release a seed in their life. Because most people, when you ask them how you doing, they say, yeah, you know, I'm okay, you know, I'm hanging there, you know, things not going good. When people ask you, I am wonderful, I am fresh in you.
Amen.
They can be shocked. That's all right. Let them shock. Okay, so Paul said, look at you now. He said, everything is new. He said, although you were once distant and far away from God. He said, now. Can somebody say, now? You have been brought delightfully close to Him through the sacred blood of Jesus. Yeah. Oh my goodness. Of Jesus. He said, you have actually been united to Christ. Hold on, let me get the first part first. Let me get the first part first. He said, now you have been brought delightfully. Oh my God. It's not something who's going to happen. It's something that's already happened. Somebody said, Joseph, what is my part in that? Believe it, believe it, believe it. Receive it, receive it. That's why, you know, sometimes I keep telling you, you know, say amen. Say, I receive it. Say, yes. Be excited about it. If you know it is for you, if you know it is true. He says, now, directly close to Him, we close to God. He said, through the sacred blood of Jesus.
Amen, Lord Jesus. Thank you.
Some of you don't even know how close you are from God. You are so close from God. I don't know if any of you experienced that before. You just say something in your heart. You just say it in your heart, and then God already give you the answer. Do I have a witness here?
Amen.
Amen.
That's how close He is from you. You just think of something, and God already give you the answer.
Yes. Amen.
That's why I don't need to sing, you know, draw me close to you. Because I believe, I know God is in me. He cannot be closer than that. How close God can be when He is in me? Can somebody say, God is in me?
God is in me.
God is in you. How close you want Him to be? When you sing, draw me close to you, you don't understand. That's what happened. You said, Joseph is a song. Yes. Whoever come with that song doesn't understand. They did not understand how close they are from God. God is in them. And this is your hope of glory. God is in you. Christ is in you. My goodness. So when you don't believe that, you're missing the whole point. Yeah, you're missing the whole thing. So now, he said, you have, I like that one. He said, you have actually been united to Christ. That word united, that's been you become one with Christ. Can somebody say, I am one with Christ?
I am one with Christ.
And let me tell you, when I say you are one with Christ, you need to understand, it's not two separate things. No. Because you are born out of Christ. My goodness. You are born out of Christ. So, Christ means the anointed one. So, you are born out of the anointed one. You are also an anointed one. You don't hear me. Let me say it again. You are also an anointed one. That's why I don't pray for anointing. Because I know, I believe, I am anointed.
Amen.
I get all the oil. The day I'm born again, I got all the oil, I can get in me. Don't let religion, fool you. Just know the truth, and the truth will set you free.
Amen.
And the truth will make you separate, different from everybody.
Amen.
That's why religious people never liked Jesus.
Right.
I want you to know that Jesus is not in religion. Religious people try to put Jesus in religion, but Jesus himself never a religious guy. Did you know that? Oh, let me step on your toes a little bit more. God is not in religion also. Because God is a living God. Religion, they are dead. You don't hear what I'm saying. Religion is dead. That's why there's no life in religion. Because God is out of religion. And he never been in religion. Religious people try to put God in the circle. But God is not there. The law demands obedience or no blessing. I love that. The law demands obedience or no blessing. What does that mean? If you don't obey, God not going to bless you. Look at that in Deuteronomy 28, verse 1 and 9. Verse 1 to 9.
Today I am giving you the laws and teachings of the Lord your God. Always obey them, and the Lord will make Israel the most famous and important nation on earth. And he will bless you in many ways. The Lord will make your business and your farm successful. You will have many children. You will harvest large crops, and your herds of cattle and flock of sheep and goats will produce many young. You will have plenty of bread to eat. The Lord will make you successful in your daily work. The Lord will help you defeat your enemies and make them scatter in all directions. The Lord your God is giving you the land, and he will make sure you are successful in everything you do. Your harvest will be so large that your storehouse will be full. Mm-hmm. If you follow and obey the Lord, he will make you his own special people, just as he promised.
All right. There is a condition in all the promise. He said, if you follow and obey the Lord, he will make you his own special people. Guess what? In the grace, we are born as special people of God. Do you hear what I'm saying? I said, in the grace, you are born. So it's not about what you do who make you. It's just what God has done for you who make you who you are. A lot of religious people love these scriptures. Oh, some people, they wear these scriptures, you know, almost, you know, every week, every service, you know. God will bless you. God will make you successful. God will do this. God will do that. Let me tell you. The devil just a liar. God already put everything in you. As a matter of fact, Jesus said, I took your poverty and give you my riches. So when you are born again, you are born of God riches. So that's why you need to know and believe you are rich. You don't hear what I'm saying. You need to know that. And that was the word of Jesus. He said, you know, I took your poverty and give you my riches. So that's when you are born again, you are born rich. But now, hear the trick. When you don't believe that, because you are $35 negative in the bank account, so you don't believe that, just what happened, you are not going to see it. Because the trick is, you have to believe it first, and then your $35 negative, you know, going to be positive.
Yes.
All right. So look at grace brings obedience because of the blessing. You are not blessed because you obey, but you obey because you are blessed. Oh, I love that one. Ooh, my goodness. Where we at? 1 John chapter 4, verse 16 to 19. 1 John 4, 16 to 19. Somebody read this for you, please.
We have come into an intimate experience with God's love, and we trust in love and the love he has for us. God is love. Those who are living in love are living in God, and God lives through them. Mm-hmm. By living in God, love has been brought to its full expression in us so that we may fearlessly face the day of judgment. Because all that Jesus now is, so are we in this world. Love never brings fear, for fear is always related to punishment. But love's perfection drives the fear of punishment far from our hearts. Whoever walks constantly afraid of punishment has not reached love's perfection. Our love for others is our grateful response to the love God first demonstrated to us.
Oh my goodness. Our love... That's why, I mean, you need to get out of religion, seriously, because religion will mess you up. That's why some religious people, they try to love people. They tried to love people and forgot to love them. He used to be like that in the Old Testament, under the law. But under the grace, when you are born again, you are born of love. So you born as a lovely person. Do you hear me? Can somebody say, I am lovely?
I am lovely.
I'm looking for excited people. You know. I understand. You probably never said that to yourself before. I understand that. You know, but I mean, just, you know, bear with me. You can understand, you know, who you really are. Then somebody said, I am lovely.
I am lovely.
You are lovely because you are born of God's love.
Amen.
There's a lot of things John says in the scripture, but I just want to talk in the last part. He said, our love for others is our graceful response to the love God first demonstrated to us.
Yes.
So do not try to love people. Don't do that. Don't try to love them. Just love them.
Amen.
Because you are lovely.
Yes.
That's why sometimes you need to get up in the morning and say, I am lovely. Thank you, Father, because you made me so lovely. I'm going to love everybody, even those who doesn't love me. I don't care. I'm sure the Spirit of God will give you a special visit like that. We love because, you know, God loves us. Not because we're looking for a blessing. You know, we're looking for a blessing. We try to love. You know, some people say, I can't love everybody. I can't. But guess what? When you know you are lovely, guess what happened? You don't have nothing else in you you can give except love.
Amen.
You don't hear what I'm saying. Everything in you is love. It's based on love. Oh my goodness. The law cries out, stone the prodigal. The law cries out. I love that one. I love it. The law cries out, stone the prodigal. And the grace cries out, put the best robe on the prodigal. So look at Deuteronomy 21, verse 18 to 21. Go ahead, somebody.
A father and a mother may have a stubborn and rebellious son who refuses to obey them even after he has been punished. If a son is like that, his parents must drag him to the town gate where the leaders of the town hold their meetings. The parents will tell the leaders, the son of ours is stubborn and never obeys. He spends all his time drinking and partying. The men of the town will stone that son to death, because they must get rid of the evil he brought into the community. Everyone in Israel will be afraid when they hear how he was punished.
Did you read that? Did you have that in your Bible? Did you hear what she read? So that's why you need to be very careful. Because people can show you, you can stone your son and your daughter with the scripture in him. That's what I'm trying to for you to wake you up. Because some of us just believe, you know, if it is the Bible, you know, it's the Bible, it's good. Be careful. It's not everything in the Bible, it belongs to you. Or if everything belongs to you, show me your son, so we're going to kill him together. That's what the verse says, right?
Yes.
If you have a rebellious son, he doesn't want to listen to you, after you punish him, you know, drag him to the leaders, you know, for them to stone them to death. Don't you read that?
Yeah.
That's what the scripture says. So that's why you need to be careful with religious people. Okay? So now, understand that the grace cries out, put the best robe on the portico. Kill the fat calf. He said, let us feast and be merry. So you find that story in Luke chapter 15, verse 20 to 24. I'm going to read this for you. He says, so the young son set off for home from a long distance away. His father saw him coming, dressed as a beggar, in great compassion, swelled up in his heart for his son who was returning home. So that story, you need to understand the beginning of that story. A father has two sons, and that story, Jesus was the teller of that story. So he said, a father has two sons. One of them said to the father, you know what? Give me my portion of heritage. Even though you're still alive, I'm not too care about that, but I know you're going to die anyhow, but give me my portion. And guess what happened? The father just gave him his portion. And then after a couple months or maybe weeks, he just left the house and went, you know, somewhere else, partying, you know, having fun, you know, be happy, you know, live life. And guess what? Everything he had just gone. You know, because when you take yourself out of your father is the source. So whatever you had, they're going. They leave you because you disconnected from your source. He left. And then after he spent everything, guess what? There is nothing else for him to do in that country because they have a famine there. And then one day he decided to come back. And then he said in himself, hey, the servant of my father's house live a better life than me here. So I'm going back to tell my father, please accept me not as a son, but as a servant. Okay? That's the difference between religion and the kingdom. Because in religion, you know, people become servants. In the kingdom, we are sons and daughters. That's two different things. So now, understand that. He said, the father now saw him coming back. Okay? And then a great compassion swelled up in the father's heart for his son who was returning home. Now, he said, so the father raced out to meet him. So the father saw him coming. He just ran, you know, to meet him. He said, he swept him up in his arm. He just embraced him and hugged him dearly and kissed him over and over with tender love. That's what the father did. Now, watch this. He said, then the son said, that's the son's word. He said, Father, I was wrong. I have sinned against you. I could never deserve to be called your son. Just let me be. As he reached that point, the father just stopped him. Hear the father now. The father answered him. The father interrupted him and said, "Son." Oh, I love that. What the father said? "Son." He said, "You are whom now? Forget about your repentance. Forget about what you had, you know, what you already planned for you to, you know, say to me. Forget about that. Now you are who?" What a wonderful father is that? He got to be God. He said, turning to his servant. So the father turning to his servant. For what purpose? The father said, "Quick, bring me the best robe, my very own robe, and I will place it on his shoulders." I assure you, the law said, "Kill your rebellion, son." But the grace said, "Put the best robe on him." My goodness. Said, "Bring the ring, the seal of sonship." That's what the meaning of the ring. That means you have authority. That means you are my son. Okay, the seal of sonship, and I will put it on his finger, and bring out the best shoes you can find for my son. He said, "Let's prepare a great feast and celebrate."
Amen.
My goodness. He said, "For this beloved son of mine was once dead." Did he was dead? Ah, let's get something out of that. Did the son was dead? Talk to me. Did the son was dead? He talking to the son. I mean, he talking to the servant now, but the son in front of him. So what happened? He considered the son was dead because every time you are disconnected with your source, with your father, you are dead to your father. Do you get this?
Yes.
Every time you are disconnected, you know, to God, guess what happened?
Okay.
You're dead.
We're lost.
So that's why the father looked at him or saw him as a dead person, a dead son who come back alive. He said, "But now he's alive again." He said, "Once he was lost, but now he is found." And everyone celebrated with overflowing joy. So that was Jesus who gave that story. I am sure Jesus knew the Old Testament because he is the living Word of God. And then he just bring that story, knowing who the Father is, knowing who God really is, and just to show us how merciful, how wonderful God is. So we don't show love because we want God to love us. We don't forgive others because we want God to forgive us. No, God already forgive us. So that's why we have abundance of forgiveness to give to people. We're going to stop here tonight, but we still have some more difference between law and grace. Thank you, family and friends, for watching us live on Facebook. If you have any questions, you can always, you know, post your question, post your comment. If you like this video, just like it. If you don't like it, you know, you can share it. Maybe somebody else may like it. You might say, well, Joseph, I would like to be a son. What do I need to do? Everything starts with Jesus. The birth comes from Jesus. The way to receive him is just simple. Just say, Lord Jesus, please forgive me of all of my sin. I know you are my Savior, the one who came to took away my sin. Right now, I give you my sin. Take them away from me, please. I accept you as my Lord and my Savior. Guess what? As soon as you said that and you believe in your heart, you know, Jesus is your Lord and your Savior. Guess what happened? You become a citizen. You become a son in God's kingdom. Yes, thank you. Remember, we are in Christmas season. You know, a lot of people, you know, willing to give gift. Hey, give somebody this gift. The Consciousness of Righteousness. You can click on the link below if you want to get this book. So you can give a gift who can change people's life. Not just a gift, you know, you give them something, you know, for them to eat or drink. You know, but give them something, you know, who can last them forever. Remember, we love you and stay blessed, family and friends. Thank you.